1,000 years ago, southern New Mexico was locked in a 100-year-long drought. The few rivers in the region weren't much more than streams. The seasonal rains people relied on to grow their corn crops didn't arrive. Plants and animals that people hunted and gathered became sparser and sparser. Forest fires were rampant. Yet despite this, the people who lived in the region, whom archaeologists have termed the Mimbres, flourished. In this video, I'll tell you about these people and how the resilience allowed them to persist through the worst drought in southwest New Mexico in the last 1,300 years. We'll talk about how archaeologists are able to learn about ancient climates and what they were like, how people adapted to them, and how we can use this information to adapt to modern climate change. Before we begin, let's establish a few ground rules. First and foremost, I'm an archaeologist. Who knows what archaeologists study? I'll give you a big hint. It's not dinosaurs. Paleontologists study dinosaurs. Archaeologists study people who lived hundreds or thousands of years ago, and we use a variety of tools and methods to do so. I wear many different hats as an archaeologist, like this one, to protect me from the sun while excavating a site. Other times I don't wear a hat at all, like when I'm sorting artifacts in the lab or analyzing data at my computer.
One of the reasons I love being an archaeologist is that I get to use many different scientific techniques to learn about the past. I'm going to explain a few of those techniques in this video, especially how archaeologists can learn what the past environment was like.
I'll start by introducing you to the Mimbres region, where I conduct research. The Mimbres region is located in southwest New Mexico. Though it's hot and dry there, the landscape isn't entirely desert, especially in the north, which contains the Gila National Forest and Mogollon Mountains. There are also rivers, most notably the Gila and Mimbres River. The ancestors of modern-day Native American people lived in the Mimbres region, particularly along river valleys, for thousands of years. For most of their history, they were mobile people who foraged, gathered, and hunted food. Then, around 1,500 years ago, they started growing corn and living in more permanent settlements called pit house villages. Archaeologists call this period of time the pit house period, named after the types of houses people lived in. Pit houses are houses that had floors dug into the ground, ramp entrances, hearths for warmth and cooking, and roofs and walls made of tree beams covered with mud. During the late pit house period, people also made black and white ceramics with geometric designs. They held religious and communal ceremonies in big underground structures called great kivas. Most villages were small, with 4 to 5 groups of a few pit houses, likely all extended families. By 1100 AD, during what archaeologists call the Mimbres Classic period, Mimbres society had entirely transformed. People now lived in above-ground structures called room blocks that are similar to the apartment-style pueblos that some southwestern Native American groups live in today. Ceramics featured images of plants, animals, people, and supernatural beings. Ceremonies weren't held in great kivas, but out in the open, in plaza spaces between room blocks. In other words, Mimbres society had entirely transformed. Though archaeologists have known about the differences between the late pit house and classic periods for years, prior to my research, no one had linked these dramatic cultural changes to an intense drought. This was in large part because of expectations archaeologists had about how humans react to severe environmental changes. Spoiler alert, usually not well. But that wasn't the case for the Mimbres. Mimbres society was able to flourish during a severe environmental downturn, which I think is a positive lesson as our modern world is experiencing dramatic climate change. But before we talk about that, I want to explore how archaeologists can learn about ancient environments. So how do we know that 900 to 1000 AD was a time of severe drought in southwest New Mexico? Scientists can use many different methods and tools to learn what the environment was like in the past. One of the main methods used in desert regions is through the study of tree rings, called dendrochronology. You certainly know that we can tell how old a tree is by counting its rings. But did you also know that tree rings provide a record of how wet or dry a region was? This is because in periods of drought, tree rings grow thin. But when there's periods of rain, tree rings grow thick. In other words, when a tree gets enough or more than enough water, it can grow bigger and sturdier during a year. But if it doesn't get enough water, it can't grow as much, and therefore the ring it makes in a year is smaller. Thus, a tree with many consecutive thin rings suggests drought struck where it lived sometime during the tree's life. Of course, determining if a place had a drought isn't as easy as studying the rings of one tree. Archaeologists need to compare hundreds or thousands of samples from many different sites to learn how severe or extensive a drought may have been. and we can't use living trees to learn about ancient times, since their rings only go back a few hundred years. So archaeologists must excavate tree ring samples to use them to learn about the ancient past. Unfortunately, in most cases, trees start to decompose once they die, so they aren't very common in the archaeological record. However, and though it might sound surprising, burning can actually help preserve trees or the beams or wood from them. In the Mimbres region, most of the tree ring data archaeologists have collected comes from the burned roofs of pit houses, room blocks, or great kivas. Here you can see us collecting tree ring samples from a Mimbres site I excavated called Woodrow Ruin. By comparing tree rings from archaeological sites across southwest New Mexico, archaeologists have determined that the period of 900 to 1000 AD was very dry, the driest the region has been in the last 1300 years. Archaeologists have other methods for studying what the environment was like in the past. We can look at the remains of plants and animals from a particular place and see how they changed through time to make inferences about environmental transformations. In the U.S. Southwest, an example of this is cottontail rabbits and jackrabbits. Cottontails and jackrabbits have evolved different traits that allow them to survive in different environments. You've almost certainly seen a cottontail before. These rabbits are found everywhere. Though they're common, they need sufficient water, foraging material, and plant coverage to eat, hide, and survive. Jackrabbits, on the other hand, well, they aren't actually rabbits, but hares. They're known for having big ears, but they also have better eyesight than cottontails and can run faster and jump higher, too. These adaptations allow jackrabbits to flourish in drier environments with less plant coverage. Because of the adaptations jackrabbits and cottontails have for different types of environments, archaeologists can study their remains to learn how the environment in a particular place may have changed through time. As an example, let's say archaeologists are excavating a site that was occupied from 700 AD to 900 AD. At a part of the site that dates to 800 AD, the archaeologists find 80 cottontail bones and 20 jackrabbit bones. The archaeologists then find 20 cottontail bones and 80 jackrabbit bones at the part of the site that dates to 900 AD. What do you think this could suggest about changes to the environment? Since archaeologists found many more cottontail bones at 800 AD, this could mean the environment at that time was fairly wet and had decent plant coverage, since this is the type of environment cottontails thrive in. The dramatic change in numbers 100 years later, with many more jackrabbit bones, suggests the environment had changed, and that it was much drier with less plants, which jackrabbits prefer. Tree rings and bunny bones are just two of the ways that archaeologists can learn about the environment of the past. There are many more techniques like ice coring, analysis of plant remains, and ancient DNA. Regardless of the methods used, a pattern that has become clear in the study of ancient cultures across the globe is that evidence of environmental deterioration, such as drought, almost always correlates with societal stress or decline. To give just a couple of examples, for the ancient Maya of Central America, drought, deforestation, and overfarming all likely contributed to collapse at around 900 AD. In an entirely different time and place, a recent study just found that drought was coincident with the decline of ancient Turkey's Hittite Empire around 1200 BC.
But the Mimbres region is an exception to this rule. People didn't leave while experiencing a 100-year-long drought. Instead, the people who lived in the Mimbres region transformed their society between the start and the end of a drought. I argue this cultural adaptability gave them resilience during environmental disaster. By changing how their villages were organized, how they interpreted their world, and how they interacted with one another and their neighbors, the people who lived in the Mimbres region 1,000 years ago were able to survive environmental disaster, which is not what we typically see in the archaeological record.
This is an important lesson for today's society, as we face a rapidly changing environment. The archaeological record tells us that if we don't change, if we keep burning fossil fuels, cutting down rainforests, building in areas prone to flooding or drought, and more, we should expect environmental disasters that could harm human societies. That's the bad news. The good news is that the archaeological record of the Mimbres region suggests an alternative future is also possible. If we modify how we live and how we interact with the environment, we can be resilient to climate change. I hope you've enjoyed learning about how archaeologists study the past and how we can apply what we've learned to today's society. Please reach out if you'd like to learn more about this topic or any of the other ways that archaeologists use science to learn about the past.